Okay, whenever you're ready.
Go.
This is another in our series of Iowa Broadcasting History interviews. We're doing this one on the 19th day of March in 1997. And the gentleman beside me is a very familiar face to television audiences in eastern Iowa and to the many people who attended ballrooms around eastern Iowa in the 50s and, well, farther back than that. This is Leo Greco. Thanks for being here, Leo.
Hey, it's my pleasure.
It's really great to have you here. So, out of, let's see, you were on WMT radio with your band starting when?
In 48.
And on television?
And we started it in 53.
And you went on television until?
69. Television, radio, both till 69.
Till 69. So it was Leo Greco and the Pioneers.
That's the way we started out, and then when we expanded our territory, we just called it Leo Greco and his band.
Leo Greco and his band. And so a lot of people saw you. You met a lot of people over those many years.
Many, many people.
Well, let's back the tape up a little bit here now and talk about, find out where Leo came from. Out of Owine, I know that.
Born and raised in Owine, November 1, 1921. All Saints Day, don't ask me how that happened.
And it's today. This is your birthday?
No, All Saints Day, November 1.
Oh, no, okay.
This is St. Joseph's Day.
I got my Catholic calendar mixed up a little bit here, Leo. Excuse me.
It's all right.
Okay. And went to high school there.
Went to Sacred Heart.
Mm-hmm. Is that where you learned to play the accordion?
Actually, a gentleman from by the name of Al Girardi came in from Cedar Rapids and taught me there, and then Mrs. Sloan took over when Al got out of the business.
And the accordion was your instrument?
Accordion. At 10 years old, back in those days, they didn't ask if you wanted to play. And Dad bought the accordion, put it in my hands, and said, play.
Say, here.
This is it, but I enjoyed it.
Yeah, right.
It's always been fun.
Josh, I'm going to tell you, I want you to come in on Leo during this. I want you to concentrate the video on him rather than sitting on the two shot, okay? Yeah. Well, let's continue, Leo. So at 17, with your accordion, you headed to Cedar Rapids.
That's right.
And what did you do there?
Well, I stayed with Mrs. Sloan for a couple of weeks. That was my teacher. Her and her husband invited me to stay there. And then I moved over to the YMCA. In the meantime, to make a living, I would play in the taverns at night to get the experience of, you know, and then also deliver papers and move pianos in the daytime. I had two, three different jobs in the daytime that kept me busy all week long.
Uh-huh.
And then Jack Nye from the Don Siebert and his Texans came in one night and says, hey, we're looking for an accordion player. And I said, good, I'm looking for a band to play. So that was Don Siebert's Texans. I was with Don and the boys for about a year. And then they changed it to Uncle Elmer and his Daffy Duder. Excuse me.
Yeah.
And then from Uncle Elmer and his Daffy Duders, we changed the band again and moved to Des Moines. And it was a Six Notes of Harmony. That was in 41.
I see.
Then in 41, in 42, I joined the Navy. I was there about a year in Des Moines at the Ernie's West End Coffee Shop.
Mm-hmm.
And then I went into service in 42 and came out in 45.
Had your destroyer shot out from under you over in the Pacific?
No, off of the east, off of Okinawa.
Okinawa, right.
East China Sea, I'll get there eventually.
Right, okay.
Mm-hmm.
And you were one of the survivors?
Well, we had 150 survivors, and we had 325 personnel. Actually, we had a few more than that, but that's what's in the book, 150.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Well, so you came back from some pretty tough World War II service back
yes,
to Cedar Rapids.
Right.
And you decided maybe it's time to think about a partner for life and got interested in that.
Yes, I did.
And who was she?
Louise Duggar from Orrin, Iowa. See,
uh-huh.
I came from Orrin, Orrin's 10 miles.
Sure.
We stood up for my uncle and aunt when I was 17, and she actually was about 15 because she's 2 years younger than I am.
Uh-huh.
So we got married, and I promised her I would never go into music business.
Oh, great.
And we're all set to go to college, and Tom Owens called me up in December of 45. Says, Leo, I need an accordion player. And I said, Tom, I promised my wife I would never get into music business because it's not the life for a married man. And he said, why don't you just bring Louise out, and we'll talk. So we went over to playing Coliseum Ballroom that night in Owine, and we talked quite a while, and then Tom made me an offer I couldn't refuse, but I said, hey, I have to refuse you, Tom, because I said, I promised my wife I would never do that. But my wife says, honey, if that is what you really want to do, then go ahead and do it.
So Louise bought into it.
She released me from my promise.
Yeah.
So everything worked out just perfect.
Yeah, that's, and she's still your life's partner.
Yeah, 51 years, going on 52.
Congratulations.
Thank you.
Yeah. Well, you used a you used a phrase there that's familiar to a lot of the older folks in eastern Iowa, Tom Owens Cowboys.
You got
which
it.
Which was a, I guess you called them a western band, didn't
Country
you?
Western band. They started in Cedar Rapids in 1937.
Okay.
Tom used to be in the WLS barn dance, and they worked there, and they came down through Iowa to do a few jobs through Iowa.
Okay.
And they just liked Cedar Rapids, so they moved there and started to work out at WMT.
Okay, well, I'm going to bring a picture up here now for a camera operator. We'll come in, and there is there's a shot of Tom Owens Cowboys, but Tom Owens isn't there.
No, Tom was the booker of the band.
He didn't he didn't appear with the band. No,
well, yes, he came to the, not on radio, but he did come to all the dance jobs. He called the score dances. So starting on the left of the trumpet man is Chuck Utsi.
Okay.
And then right behind, well, next to him is Don Watchell, and you see that head sticking up? That's the bass player. That is Jim Pye.
Okay.
And then that accordion player, of course, is yours truly. And, and Bob Goodwick is the one that ran the band. He's a guitar player.
Okay.
He did handled all the musical chores, and the guy was just fantastic.
In other words, he was really the band leader.
He was the band leader. You're right. Absolutely right.
That's this person here, then, right?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. Okay. Well, that's one shot of Tom Owens Cowboys. Now, here's another one, and we're going to get a look at some really interesting names here as we sort of work our way across here. We'll let Josh get focused up there. And why don't you just start over to the left there, Josh, and I'll try to keep the light out of it.
That's Marlon Peterson, the first gentleman.
And that, I got to get my orientation right. Okay.
That's it, where your hand is.
Okay.
And then next to him is Jim Pye, and then Don Watchell.
Okay.
And then yours truly there. And then Bub Goodwick, the leader, is the next one.
Uh-huh.
And then Chuck Utsi, the trumpet player.
All right.
And, of course, Howdy Roberts.
Howdy Roberts.
And that was Doug Grant, the program director.
At WMT.
At WMT, right.
Okay.
And then the gentleman on the end was Mr. McElroy.
R.J. McElroy, who later founded Black Hawk Broadcasting.
Right. Mm-hmm.
Okay.
Then that's the Erickson. I believe those are the Erickson boys. I think that one, the one with the guitar is Arn. Well, the one on the end is Guff Erickson.
Okay.
And then that's Arnie Erickson. And that is Dempsey Jones.
That is Dempsey Jones.
That is Dempsey Jones.
Who is another famous band leader name in...
Well, he had Dempsey Jones and his boys.
They had a trio.
Uh-huh. Terrific.
Okay.
And that's Doris Newman, I believe, a terrific accordion player next.
Whoops.
The other way.
Yeah.
And that's Doris Newman. And then next to her is Bob Leifers.
All right.
The one with the hat on.
Yeah.
Is Bob Leifers. Then next to Bob Leifers is Rosemary June.
Let's just stop there. Now, Rosemary June, that became a very big name in show business.
She moved to Broadway and was very, very successful. In fact, she lives right across from the big park in New York.
Why don't you push in on that just a little bit, Josh, and see if you can get a little closer up shot there. Yeah.
Terrific singer.
She was a nationally known singer who got her start singing with... Owens Cowboys.
No, actually, she, I think probably Leo Dutcher and Leo Cortomedia, and then probably backed her up.
Okay.
She didn't work with any of the bands out of Cedar Rapids.
Okay. She was, in other words, she was an act.
Yeah, in herself, that's
herself.
Right.
Okay. Well, that's interesting. Here's another picture, Leo. This one is, tell us where that is.
That is in Waterloo, the Dairy Cattle Congress.
And the band... played up there.
When I was at Tom Owens, we broadcast out of there.
Uh-huh. Mm-hmm. And there's a lot of people, and that was the way people got to know who radio personalities were.
That's right.
Going to fairs
and
that sort of thing.
That would have been 46 or 47.
Mm-hmm. And you'd be up there all through the show.
We broadcast from there around noontime.
Okay.
I forget the exact hour, but it was 12 or 12:30, but we did our broadcast out of there.
Well, now this is contemporary band experience. This is a Waterloo band. Tell us who this is, Leo.
Well, Lyle Harvey's the one with the scarf around his neck in the first row there.
Okay.
Better known in show business, Joe Doakes.
Joe Doakes.
Terrific guy.
Later associated with the KWWL radio and television experience.
Alrighty.
And he was quite a personality, too.
Terrific personality. Yeah. He really did a nice job.
Yeah. Okay, that'll do it on the pictures then, Josh. Well, this is quite a phenomenon, this band business. You were not only on, how often were you on the radio, what, once a week?
No, we were on the radio at 5:45 in the morning.
In the morning.
Started in 51, and we were on Monday, Wednesday, and Friday.
Okay, early in the morning.
Early in the morning.
Okay. You really had to get the pipes cleared out to get out.
We really did. And then later on, we moved to 6:30.
Mm-hmm. In the morning.
In the morning.
And in addition to that, then your band was playing ballrooms.
We were playing 6 and 7 days a week, back when we originally started.
Mm-hmm. Mostly in eastern Iowa.
Yes, at that time, mostly in eastern Iowa.
Okay, so that was a. Louise really bought a package when she said it's okay to do that, didn't
she?
She
did.
Yeah.
But then we expanded our territory.
Uh-huh.
So then in later years, we would travel 6 to 10 states. So, excuse me.
Yeah.
We would travel 6 to 10 states then. That's when we got associated with Ken Feeds. We really expanded our territory.
Okay.
And from a country and western band, we went to a variety band. We played everything, pop, country, and old time.
Mm-hmm. Okay. Well, in just a minute or two, and I'll ask Tim to roll the tape in a minute or two, but let's talk a little bit about, because I didn't realize until earlier today when we were visiting that you and your band were one of the original acts on Channel 2, WMT-TV, when they went on the air in 53, right?
53.
Yeah.
They went in September of 53, and the two bands that were on the air about the same time was Tom Owens Cowboys and my band.
I guess we didn't ask you then when you made the transition from Tom Owens Cowboys to and started your own band.
In May of 1948.
Okay.
The last day in May.
And you got on WMT radio then with Kent Feeds as a sponsor.
That was in 51. That's correct.
On radio.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. Was that a big feed company at that time?
No, small one. Just one little plant out of Muscatine, and then they grew into about 12 different states. And that's how we expanded too, because as they played different places, I mean, as they went in different places, we played to different places.
Okay.
We'd do their open houses and like the those farm deals that they have.
Yeah.
And if they were in Indiana, Illinois, or Cedar Rapids, we played them, you know.
So you had a merchandising tie-in with
That's
them.
Right.
Okay.
We really did.
Uh-huh.
It's a good word. I like that.
Yeah, and this looks like this radio and television advertising worked pretty well.
Yes, it did. Worked real good.
You were sharing a couple of examples of some of the direct experience you had to measure audience response to your show.
Well, back when we first started, we were on October through probably February, and Bob Schubert, who was with the agency at the time, said, now they're going to drop it during the summer and come back in the fall.
Uh-huh.
When I said, Bob, you know, I said, we were counting on an extra pay for the guys, and I said that my loyalty is with Kent Feeds, but if that's the case, I'll just have to look for somebody else. He said, don't do that. Let me talk to Kent Feeds, and we'll go from there.
Mm-hmm.
And so he did, and they gave away some pig nuggets. And in 1 week's time, they got well over 200, and they'd been trying to give it away in print and received hardly any inquiries, you know.
Uh-huh.
So that was the story. Then we stayed with them on radio for all those years.
So the pig nuggets put you on full time.
Full time. Because, you see, we were on at 5:45 in the morning.
And this was radio.
Yeah, this is radio, right.
Yeah.
And then television, we started in 53. We were on at 6:45 on Wednesday nights.
Uh-huh.
And then Arthur Godfrey came along and preempted our time, so we got together with the management from WMT, and they couldn't come up with the time, so we went to KCRG for a while.
Uh-huh.
But now the story that relates to that, while we were having this visit on why they couldn't come up with another time, they said, well, why don't you maybe just drop Leo Greco and go into the news, by the news.
Uh-huh.
And so they said, well, look, we've been trying to give away chicks at our Bellevue place, and they said we couldn't give them away.
Uh-huh.
They went on the air. Chuck Mooster mentioned it once on Leo's show, and the next morning by 8 o'clock, all the chicks were gone.
The chicks were all gone.
Chicks were all gone.
So you were starting to get a real, powerful reach out there.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
Okay. And so that sort of locked you in with Kent Feeds
then? Yes, it did,
and,
until 69.
Until 69, which is a long, that's a pretty long run.
It really is.
Yeah, it really is. Well, Tim, why don't you roll the tape now? And Leo has, this is a video, a tape that Leo had made in this era when you were establishing the band trying to establish it on a circuit for television, right?
This was in 55 and 56 that we did these two shows, if you show both of them.
We have, okay, I think we just have one here. So it was sort of a, and that's Chuck Wooster, who was the,
right.
He did the announcing on the show.
Terrific personality.
One of the greatest that's ever been in the business.
That's right.
And we'll hear Chuck when he does a commercial later on. Tell us who the guys are here now, Leo.
Of course, yours truly on the accordion. Bobby Andrews is behind me, that's the trumpet man.
Uh-huh.
Shorty on the sax, strumming away there. And behind Shorty is Dick Harvey. And Bob Moran is a drummer.
Mm-hmm.
Curly Meeks is back pounding a guitar, and it's Rusty Wagner on the bass.
Okay. And I think what they're doing there is, Hey, Mr. Banjo.
Yeah,
that was
right.
Your mm-hmm. first number on
that show.
On that
mm-hmm.
show. And you did this in a studio in Des Moines.
In Des Moines.
Okay.
We were going to go to film so that we could go to different markets.
Uh-huh.
But back in those days, the 32 millimeters were fine if you played them back on the 32 millimeter.
Uh-huh.
But when you played them back on TV, which nobody thought about doing, they looked worse than the old movie tone.
It was bad. Bad video.
It was worse than bad.
Uh-huh.
Whatever.
So that this particular thing didn't go at that time.
No.
So you went back to live
telecasting.
Went
back to live.
But then when videotape came along, then you did go. You went on a network.
On the videotape.
How many stations did you
have?
We
were on six.
On six stations.
Four in Iowa and two in Illinois.
Mm-hmm. So Kent was really selling feeds on
yeah, they
the
really were.
Show
mm-hmm.
by this time.
Right.
Growing into a big company. Okay, made a lot of money for some.
Excuse me.
Now this is this the band that worked with you most of the time?
Yeah,
mm-hmm.
right, the first 7 years.
Okay. Chuck's gonna come up here and do a commercial in just a minute, and we'll just talk a little bit about him. Here he comes.
Hey, what a night there, fellas. And right now, here's a word from Chuck.
It's a pleasure to have a guest with us on the show this evening. Russ
we'll just
kind of
let, why don't we take the sound Kent down here and we'll Russ, bring Bobby Chuck up full a little later on. This was a live commercial. He did,
that's
he
right.
did all his commercials live.
And you know something, he'd take a look at a script, look at it for a minute or so, throw it away and just ad-lib the whole thing.
Uh-huh.
Just about word for
he
word.
He was probably the master ad-libber of all time.
Boy, that's beautiful. He was a master.
Yeah.
That's a good word.
And of course, a lot of people, of course, they knew Chuck through your show visually, but they knew him. His bass was really radio.
In the morning. That's right.
The farm show that he did in the morning.
He was well known. In fact, when he passed away, he got killed in an accident in 1960. They had his funeral at Cole College Auditorium.
Right.
And the place was just jammed with people.
Killed in a terrible automobile accident.
Right.
Shortly after I went to work for the WMT stations. A real broadcast personality.
He was fantastic.
Yeah, right. So this television show was on at 6:15?
6:15 on Saturday nights.
On Saturday night.
Yeah.
15-minute program.
Yeah.
And what did you notice when you started to get out in the doing the live band dates after you went on television?
See, we were established really through radio.
Yeah.
And then television just cemented it.
Uh-huh.
They were both, at their time, they were both really the popular ones. Radio never did die.
Right.
To this day, it isn't dead.
No,
you know?
Of course not. And well, that to relate to that, I heard you on WMT Sunday morning.
Mm-hmm.
You're still doing radio.
That's right. I've been doing that show going on 24 years. In June, it will be 24
years.
24 years. Yeah.
And you do play... every once in a while, I hear you do the Little Red Wagon.
That's right. Well, I've got a few recordings out there,
uh-huh.
I play those also. It's a variety of pop, country, and old-time music by different bands.
Right.
Or, popular artists, country artists, polka bands.
Get a lot of requests.
Oh, man. Terrific.
So it's that WMT radio is still a pretty powerful instrument,
isn't it? It certainly is.
Yeah.
It's terrific, really.
Mm-hmm.
So, they on Sunday morning they do, well, do a good job all week long, you know.
Sure.
But when you play all those requests for all these different people, it's they become part of your family, you know what
yeah.
I mean? Just like the people listen to news or listen to whatever shows they like, they all become the open line. Whatever show they're listening to, they become part of your family.
The radio tie-in, was that important to the success of the band?
Oh, yeah.
Yeah.
That's what started
right.
it all.
Yeah.
Before
right.
television came in.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. See, even after we went on television, we continued with radio.
Yeah.
Then we went to 24 markets of radio.
On radio.
On radio.
Yeah. Okay, let's bring the sound up now and let's hear Chuck do his
Alabama
pitch.
Alabama Jubilee?
That's good for me.
All right.
Oops, no, this is a. Okay, we're going to do Alabama Jubilee before we get to the 13th. Now there's. Okay, well, let's talk some more. Well, let's listen to the band for a little bit. Let's just bring it up.
Watch your step. One lady Joe stands around on his toe. Threw away his crutch and hollered, let her go. Honey, hail, the gang's all here for the Alabama Jubilee.
That's Charleston, boy.
That's Shorty, huh?
Yeah.
I think there's probably another tune in the future.
Yeah, there is.
Longer range.
Hail, the gang's all here for the Alabama.
How many of the guys are still around, Bill?
Curly's alive, Bobby, and Dick are alive, and Bob Moran, and Rusty. Out of that group, Shorty's the only one who passed away.
Okay, so that's... They were real survivors.
Yeah, right.
Uh-huh.
Oh, no, that's a zoot suit.
Okay, it looks like we've got a hot shot coming up here now.
That's Bob Moran, very clever.
Okay, let's listen to a little of this.
I flunked in music in high school. They said I had no talent and how.
Doing the Scandinavian accent.
But them high school teachers was crazy. Just listen to me now.
So did the guys have, most of them have day jobs? Or
no, you, this is
you,
all. We had
you were full-time?
Full-time musicians.
From the Jazz Institute, I learned to sing words like a poo-poo-ba-doo. It says on my diploma, I'm a real gone-galoo. I rooty-toot-toot, too-high, rooty-toot-toot. The Bobby Sockers love me at the Jazz Institute. They
get a lot of mail from
when
the
I wear my
yeah, fantastic.
And when I croon it,
this guy
me,
here,
I'm a real gone-galoo, I'm
just,
gone.
Could take a tune that is 4 minutes long, study it for a while, like we get in the bus to go to Sioux City. By the time we got to Sioux City, he'd have it memorized.
Yeah.
It's just fantastic.
He'd have it down.
He'd have it down, Pat.
Let me digress a little bit here while we're watching this number. You crossed paths with a guy who made it even bigger than you did in the band.
Oh, yeah, much bigger.
Lawrence Welk.
Yeah, right.
Tell us about Lawrence.
Well, I met him in 48. He came to the Armour Ballroom and invited me up to stage to play an accordion tune with him or two, you know.
I see.
And we became good friends after that. And every time we go to a ballroom operators meeting, we'd we'd go out to lunch together. Then he invited us out to California. So I took my whole family out there a couple of times. Well, I'll take it back. I took the family out one time, and then my wife and I went out the other times.
Okay.
And he was just like family. Terrific guy.
So you were on the ballroom circuit with the Lawrence Welk Band during this period.
During the same period. Yeah. See, but then he moved shortly after 48, he moved to California.
I see.
Up into 48, he was in the territory.
Yeah, came out of Yankton, South Dakota.
Yeah. And that's where he broadcast from. And Tom Archer, who owned the circuit of ballrooms, Archer circuit of ballrooms, we played the same places that Lawrence did.
You did.
That's how I got to know him, and that's how we became good friends.
Mm-hmm. Okay. A
fantastic person.
Good guy. Huh?
Oh, yeah.
Yeah.
The greatest.
Yeah.
Really.
How would you like to be getting a whole okay, here comes Chuck with his Kent Feeds pitch. Let's listen.
Per month,
see if
and you're getting right now.
Some feed.
If you have 150 hens, you can get a whole case of eggs more per month by following the new Kent Poultry Feeding Program. Once again, Kent Poultry Feeds are way ahead. Now, right today, you can get the most powerful egg mashes that they've ever made with extra antibiotics, extra arsenic acid to promote growth, to give your hens what they need to make more eggs. You get 10% greater egg production. You get better livability, better health and vigor, and you can do it on 5% less feed. That's because Kent's poultry feeds have been even more improved than ever before. If you want more eggs in your poultry business, if you're getting good production now but want even better production, you see your Kent feed dealer and get a supply of those famous Kent poultry feeds. See your Kent feed dealer because he's a good man to get to know better.
Stay with it here.
Hey, boy. Oh, gee, yes. You know, I don't think the folks out there have heard this great news that we had here a while back about you being you and the gang being the third Western dance band in the nation for the third consecutive year, and congratulations are certainly in order.
Thanks a lot, Chuck, and on behalf of the fellas and myself, we certainly want to thank the ballroom operators for voting us that, and of course the folks that made it possible for us to be voted number three in the nation.
Yeah, and what's this about the being number four show band? I can't quite get the difference there. What do they mean by show band?
They also rate that during the dance job at night, when we get a lot of requests for Bob to do a novelty or the amateurs. And
really?
Do
they ask for him to do that stuff?
Yeah, you know how they ask for him? They say, when's that goofy one going to do something? And that's about right, the goofy one.
Yeah, well, that's wonderful. Gee, let's get the trio in here for a good white rapper, huh? An old favorite, I Love You True.
Right.
Okay, why don't you take the sound letter again, Tim, and we'll talk. Let's talk about that little conversation you had with Chuck. So at that time, your band was the number three ballroom band in the country, and it even got better than that.
We went to number one next year. See, that would have been 55, then in 56, 7, 8, and 9, we were number one in the nation until Downbeat discontinued the poll then.
So this was a downbeat poll.
That was a downbeat poll.
Of ballroom operators.
Ballroom operators, right. And on attendance, you know, people put most people in the ballroom.
Yeah. So that was a great testimony to what you put together, Leo. You must be proud of that.
We did a great bunch of guys.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. And you had pretty much the same bunch with you all the way through?
Then we added Jesse Goen and Bruno Randles. The other two left the band, and then we added... And then the rest, we stayed together until 69.
Uh-huh.
So I really didn't have many changes in those years.
Not many changes.
No, not many.
Mm-hmm. And you covered you expanded your circuit. You played beyond Iowa then.
We mostly played a six-state area, and then we expanded it to go down into Texas a couple times a year.
But you didn't go to California with Lawrence Welk.
No, I went to California, but not with the band.
Right.
Just to see him.
Yeah.
Uh-huh.
Well, I know that you consider yourself, your life's work is as an entertainer, and that's what's kind of, that's what drives you, isn't it?
That's it, exactly.
Yeah.
The good Lord's got us all here for a reason.
Uh-huh.
You know, because I thought at the time when Ken Feige dropped the band, which they had good reasons for, you know, things were changing in times.
So this was 69 when the Kent Feeds decided to cast their lot, their advertising in other ways, and that's when that relationship had gone on from
51 to 69.
That's a long time.
Long time.
There aren't many sponsorship contracts that ran that long.
Great company.
Yeah. And you you work with some wonderful people at WMT too.
Oh,
didn't
man.
You? What are some of the folks you recall fondly from the WMT experience?
Well, of course we start out with Mr. Quarton.
Yeah, Bill Quarton.
Bill Quarton, and then of course there was Lou Van Osterman, and Ken Hastie's the one that hired me.
He was the radio station.
He and Jerry Brady, the ones that hired me, and then, of course, who could forget Dean Lanfer and Bob Leifers?
Sure.
You know, and then of course Dempsey Jones and Toby and Susie, beautiful people. You know, they go way back.
Well, here's the closeout of the show. This is the closing commercial graphics, and we're just about done with. Was it still Leo and the Pioneers here?
No, it was Leo Greco.
Leo Greco.
Well, there it was Leo and the Pioneers.
Okay.
But then right after that, it changed into the Leo Greco and his Request Time Band.
And his Request Time Band.
Yeah, because we could play anything they wanted to hear.
Okay. Well, you mentioned a couple of names here that I'd like to have you talk a little bit more about. Dempsey Jones, he was a county official as well as an entertainer.
Yes, he was. He was. I think he was the auditor, if I remember right.
Mm-hmm.
And he and his two sons, it was called Dempsey Jones and his boys, entertained around Eastern Iowa.
Eastern Iowa.
Yeah,
mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. And They got started even before you did, didn't they?
Oh, yeah, way before. And Uncle Elmer, too, that went around, had novelty acts worked up, you know. A comedian, actually.
Right. Now, on WMT, you did morning show starting out 5 days a week, right?
No, 3 days a week.
3 days a week.
Monday, Wednesday, and Friday.
And that went on for?
Oh, for about a couple of years. And then we did a five-minute segment at 6:30.
Okay.
Time for two tunes and a commercial.
Did you do those live then?
We did those live.
You did.
And then, well, when we started, we did them live.
Uh-huh.
And then we put them on, started putting them on tape because we went into 23 markets.
Okay.
So
they were, you did a session on them, and but they were 5 minutes then.
Yeah, five-minute shows. Mm-hmm.
Yeah, I remember that.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
You mentioned another famous combination of names, Toby and Susie, and it sounds as though you used to kind of give them a hard time. How did that work?
Well, we used to be, it was on the Tom Owens Cowboys side, broadcast one studio, and they'd be over on another side taping theirs.
Yeah.
And then when we'd meet and shoot the breeze with them, they're beautiful people. They used to do these tent shows all around Iowa.
Uh-huh. And they brought that act onto radio.
Yeah, that's right. Mm-hmm.
And they were regular personalities on,
yes, they were,
on WMT radio.
For years, in the 30s and 40s.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. So. Okay. I'm sure at some point you ran across Fran Allison.
Yes, I met her, but I didn't work with her.
You didn't work with her. She was more associated with the Waterloo radio experience.
Well, now, Howdy Roberts, of course, I knew real well.
Sure. Well, Howdy was, he was out with his band. Were you kind of in competition with Howdy then?
Well, I'll tell you how that started. We used to take my band out, and Howdy would get acts from the family party, and then we'd get together and we'd go, you know, play different ballrooms.
I see.
So all at once one day, Howdy said to me, he says, Leo, I think you've got a good thing going. I think I'll just start my own band and do my own thing. And I said, that sounds fine to me. So that's how that started. That's how he started his band.
So he was, right. And Howdy, of course, started with WMT Radio back in the 30s when the studios were in Waterloo, then moved to Cedar Rapids with them. So that's how he got started in the band business. So you sort of launched him into the band business then.
Well, I guess I never thought about it that way, but I'll have to ask Howdy if that's the case. But yeah, I think that's the way, that's what he told me, that's how it happened.
Mm-hmm. I'm going to reach down here and get one of these pictures again because you used up. There's that term, the WMT family party. What was that, Leo? This is where you were with the Cowboys.
Yeah, we used to broadcast at the YMCA, and it's a gymnasium, actually an auditorium, where people would come and see us do the show live.
Once a week?
Yeah, Saturday afternoons.
Saturday afternoon.
About 12 o'clock.
Uh-huh.
And we'd do it from the YMCA then.
So this was a radio broadcast.
Radio broadcast.
But you had a live audience.
Right. Mm-hmm.
Did you attract some pretty good crowds there?
Always full.
Uh-huh.
Always. Just packed them in. See, you gotta remember, those were the days before television, so the only entertainment they had was in the ballrooms, and if the live band showed up anyplace, you know, for doing shows and things.
Yeah. Did you have any sense in those days of really how powerful an instrument that radio station was?
Oh, you bet. You bet, because you go into a ballroom and pack them in like sardines. And you knew radio was doing it, because that's the only vehicle you had, you know. So it was terrific.
So the fact that you were taking the beat up of getting up in the morning to be on the radio was worth it in order to generate the business in the ballroom.
You bet it was. You bet. That was the key to it, really.
That was the key to it.
Without the advertising, well, you know, you'd have done all right, but because back in those days, that was the only entertainment. But with radio, you became a personality, you know.
Well, again, if you can relate to the... Again, I think it's really interesting. I did not know that Kent Feed started out as a little feed mill in Muscatine. Do you have any idea the growth of that business during the period that they were your sponsor?
When we started, they had the one market in Muscatine, and then when we left them in 69, they were in 12 different states. Mm.
From one small county market to a 12-state market.
Right. Mm.
They did some other advertising, I suppose.
Oh, certainly.
Yeah.
They did newspaper and the print. They did it all.
Did they give you? Did they ever give you credit?
Oh, you bet they did. They treated us really right.
Uh huh.
They were a good operation.
They understood. Did they understand how valuable that advertising was to the growth of their business?
You bet. They used to take surveys every year.
Uh huh.
And I mean every year. So, and even when they took the last survey, the surveys were good, but they had good reasons for, you know, like I had mentioned to you earlier when we were talking.
There were some business decisions.
Business decision they had to make, and I have to say I really agree with them.
Well, then in 69, you sort of retired from the active band business. Did you did the band break up at that
point? Yes, I folded up the band December 6, 1969. Our last job was at Modder's Ballroom and Decor.
I see that.
See how well I remember that?
Right. That was your sort of your band swan song.
That was the swan song.
You remember where you made your first appearance?
Monona, Iowa, Fireman's Dance. We were actually supposed to start the 1st of June at Moonlight Gardens in East Dubuque, Illinois. But I think it was Bob Hersham, another band leader, used to work with the Cedar Valley Cowboys. Cedar Valley Hillbillies. They were looking for a band, and he was busy, and he said, why don't you call Leo Greco? He's starting up a band. So I started the night before the 1st of June.
I see.
And so worked Monona then.
Any place in eastern Iowa that you didn't play?
Believe me, every nook and cranny, you name it, we've just about played it.
Yeah.
Very few.
Yeah.
And that we miss.
And then you did a lot of personal appearances, like at your Kent Feed kickoffs
All
and that
Kent
sort of.
Kent Feed kickoffs, open houses, their banquets that we played, did entertaining, put together shows for the entertainment, a little bit different dancing.
Yeah.
Did everything.
But the foundation for this whole experience really was ballroom dancing, wasn't it?
That's the bread and butter.
Yeah.
Yeah.
People like to do that.
They loved to back in those days.
Yeah.
Yeah. That's the only entertainment they really had, you know. There wasn't that much.
And it was entertainment that came out to the small towns.
We went to them.
Yeah.
And they came out to see us.
Yeah. And they came out to see you because they'd heard you on WMT radio.
That's when they really
couldn't avoid it with that signal in those days, could
that's
they?
That's when we started getting the big crowds, that's right.
There weren't, at that time, WHO, I'm thinking of other radio stations.
WLS.
WLS.
There weren't too many back then.
There was no KOEL or there was no.
No, I don't know if KCRG had started then or not, but they came late. Well, KOEL was actually, they were there in 51.
Yeah, okay. Yeah. The radio lock-in on WMT had occurred long before that.
Oh yeah, you bet. Because they've been around that much longer.
Yeah.
See, they started in 21 in Waterloo here.
You bet. Right. Well, you don't have any regrets, I see.
None. I'm a firm believer the good Lord's got a plan for all of us.
Yeah.
I've always believed that.
And you like the one He had for you.
I love it.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And you're doing great. And I know you've got a wonderful family. Tell us a little bit about your family.
Well, we have five children. And my oldest son, Larry, is a detective.
Uh-huh.
And he's married, and we have two grandchildren with them. And then our oldest daughter, Linda, lives in Denver. And she's married. They have no children. Her and Mike, of course, live in Denver. And then number two daughter is Luann, and she's married and lives in Wilmer, Minnesota. And Frank and Lou have two children, Danny and Katie. And then number three daughter lives in Marion, and we have her and Jeff. We have one grandson, Alex, with them, who's 3 years old.
I see.
Keeping us young.
Oh, that's keeping grandpa.
And then number five is our youngest son, and that's Lance, and he's married to Lisa, and they're expecting a baby in about 4 months.
So you're going to get some more grandfathers.
That's right.
Yeah.
We love it.
Yeah, I'm sure you do.
Married to just one. Did I say I was married to just a wonderful wife?
When you told me that she gave you permission to break your promise about going with a band, I pretty well figured that out, Leo.
You got it. You got it.
That's a great story.
Yeah, she said, whatever makes you happy will make me happy.
Yeah. And it's worked out that way.
Been a great life.
Yeah, and she's doing pretty well.
Yeah, she's getting along.
That's great. I don't see any of us getting any younger, though, do
no,
you?
No, no. Do you notice my hair is still black? You notice how black it is?
Yeah, I
get
the picture
here.
Yeah, when I first saw that picture we showed early on, I had never seen Leo Greco at that stage of his life. So it was interesting to see it.
I was only 24 then.
Yeah. You know, started at 17.
Yeah, I started at 17.
And
well, actually, I played my first job in 35 with an outfit called Tom Bolin, B-O-L-E-Y-N.
Okay.
Cowboys in Owine.
Uh-huh.
That's when I started in the music business.
Okay.
Played some dance jobs with him while I was just a youngster.
Still in high school.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Well, Leo, I think we've pretty well covered the ground. Any parting words that you have for us here? I don't know who's ever going to see this, but we're getting it on tape, so.
Grant, I've always considered you a real pro, and it's been a pleasure just visiting with you for a while.
Well, it's been my pleasure.
Thank you, sir.
Thanks for coming.
Thank you kindly.
Really appreciate it. Okay. You can. Okay, this is a Iowa Broadcasting History, oral history, which we're taping on the 24th day of March, 1997, and on my left, your right here, let me introduce you to my old friend, Bob Nance, of a former WMT colleague,
yes,
going back into the late 1950s and 60s, WMT's farm director for many years. Nice to have you here, Bob.
Thank you. It's good to be your guest. Thank you.